too distant future, it will be possible for the historic friendship between us once again to find reflection in normal relations of every sort. Meanwhile, our sympathy goes out to the people of Cuba, now suffering under the yoke of a dictator.
Laos, strategic is also concerned by all the world as fighting intensifies between communist rebel forces and pro-Western regime. Numbers are fighting in mountainous, densely forested tonight. Towns and cities are isolated bare spots, linked only by crude roads. Information on events is scanning. America charges massive outside aid by Russia and Red China, and the Soviet concedes its airlifted supplies to the rebels. These last films show the battle in which government troops ousted rebels from Vientiane, the capital. Now a new thrust is directed against the royal city of Luang Prabang. American fleet and marine units are in readiness. The conflict widens, but hope continues that some solution can be found which will restore Laos to its status.
Well, sir, you are 2001 now, isn't it?
2001 years young, how we say, not to curse ourselves.
Well, you're not an old man. You don't look like an old man to me, sir.
No, I keep myself young, and I keep it by exercise.
Exercising?
Yes, that's the key to my door.
The key to your door to health, you're trying to...
To health, yes. Thanks for the ending of that.
Yes. Well, yes, now, what kind of exercise do you do? Because this might interest all of us.
Well...
And everybody wants to live a long time.
Of course. What else?
Yeah.
I open my window in the morning, and I inhale, exhale, exhale. Wait. Inhale, exhale. Well, you know the sequence.
Yes. alternately.
Yes. And then I extend my arms forward, and I drop to my knees.
Get more flavor from your coffee. A cup and a half of flavor. Get instant Maxwell House coffee.
The record of many decades stands as proof that our people and their government have, in the main, understood these truths and have responded to them well in the face of threat and stress. But threats, new in kind or degree, constantly arise. Of these, I mention two only. A vital element in keeping the peace is our military establishment. Our arms must be mighty, ready for instant action, so that no potential aggressor may be tempted to risk his own destruction. Our military organization today bears little relation to that known of any of my predecessors in peacetime, or indeed by the fighting men of World War II or Korea. Until the latest of our world conflicts, the United States had no armaments industry. American makers of plowshares could, with time and as required, make swords as well. But we can no longer risk emergency improvisation of national defense. We have been compelled to create a permanent armaments industry of vast proportions. Added to this, 3.5 million men and women are directly engaged in the defense establishment. We annually spend on military security alone more than the net income of all United States corporations. Now, this conjunction of an immense military establishment and a large arms industry is new in the American experience. The total influence, economic, political, even spiritual, is felt in every city, every state house, every office of the federal government. We recognize the imperative need for this development, yet we must not fail to comprehend its grave implications. Our toil, resources, and livelihood are all involved. So is the very structure of our society. In the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwarranted influence, whether sought or unsought, by the military-industrial complex. The potential for the disastrous rise of misplaced power exists and will persist. We must never let the weight of this combination endanger our liberties or democratic processes. We should take nothing for granted. Only an alert and knowledgeable citizenry can compel the proper meshing of the huge industrial and military machinery of defense with our peaceful methods and goals.
Attention, there's been a new invention. It isn't any larger than an adding machine. It's only fair to mention, though it's a new invention, it's one that you have heard about but few have ever seen. It doesn't do division and it doesn't multiply. It doesn't want to be a bird, it doesn't try to fly. It came about because they made a big atomic bomb. The new invention's clicking, and because of all its ticking, I know where the idea came from. I tick, 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 why do I tick, tick? What amazing trick makes me tick, tick, tick. I tick, 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 an electric tick. When I feel a realistic tick, you're such an attractive pick. Give me a radioactive kick. It's distracted the way you stick, but love, love makes me tick. I tick, 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 and my heart beats quick. How can anything go wrong when I'm listening to that Geiger counter song? You'll tick, tick all day long, like the butcher and the baker ticks, like the candlestick maker ticks, like the doctor and the lawyer ticks, even though he's mixed up in his politics, like the merchant and the Indian chief tick, ticks, like the poor and like the rich man tick, tick.
Okay, that's enough of that. I hope everybody is well. Happy 1961. And let's jump right into it. I am certainly going to make it a goal to make these videos a lot shorter and a lot more to the point. To that regard, of course, I've just... my notes are nowhere to be found, so I'm probably only going to do about 3 launches on this. They're going to be the major launches that mattered. The other launches generally are ones that don't necessarily that are versions of many other launches that have happened. So not that big a deal. The first one of that year, 1961, that I'm going to do is going to be the Venera 1 probe. So that's Venus, the very first semi-successful Venus probe. And... They lost contact with it before it actually did its flyby of the planet Venus, but according to the math, the thing did fly by Venus. I think I actually may do the... It takes many months. It takes a few months for the spacecraft to get from Venus to... from Earth to Venus. Or in the game here, from Kerbin to Venus. I'm going to tell you exactly how long the original one took. Let's see. They launched it in February 12th, 1961. You know what? Let me just jump straight into it. So I did pre-design it. It's based on the original, the R7 launcher, the same type of launcher with Sputnik. It's based on this, what they had, the Russians' larger version of the rocket, the Munira, I believe is how it's pronounced. I better make sure that Munira rocket. Monia, is lightning. So it's very similar to the standard four stage and then central core stage rocket, the same one used to launch the lunar probes from the Soviets, and the same type of same look that a spacecraft has to this very day. And make sure my voice can be heard here. Yes, it can. Good. Yeah, so like I said, I am going to try to make these videos a little bit shorter. I don't intend this to go on for hours. I'm going to just try to stick with three separate launches. One of them is going to be the Venus probe. The other one is going to be the first manned space flight of Yuri Gagarin on the Vostok 1 launcher. And then I'm also, the third one that I'm going to do isn't actually going to be a orbital launch. It's going to be a suborbital launch. That would be the launch of the Mercury Redstone 3 of Alan Shepard. He is the first American in space. The Americans took it a bit slower in their manned program. Now, remember, the Vostok program and the Mercury program, those are the manned space flights from the Soviets and the Americans, respectively. Mercury is just single-person spacecraft. Anyway, we'll get into that. The Venera probe. So this giant trash can-looking thing is the first Venera probe. Venus and Mars, obviously, are our two closest planets, so these got a lot of attention within the launch windows. Now, I didn't try to make mine look too pretty. however, I did make sure that I could properly just launch within that direction in some test launches. So we're not just... Now, in the game, the planet is called Eve. So I've called this Eva 1 instead of Venera 1. Oh, I also did a bit of a redesign of my booster. It's still the bottom part. It's the same size, but I did have to make the top part a little bit fatter to accommodate for just the increasing size. The way that the game increases, it's the size of the diameter. A lot of this stuff doesn't really make up with real stuff, so it's a little bit awkward looking. I think I'll get used to it. So this is going to be our Venera probe. So the first thing sent to Venus, it's sent on a flyby of Venus. I believe I'm already in a proper transfer window. So I'm going to make sure of that. I'm going to demonstrate the actual, well, you know what, we'll demonstrate that once we get this thing launched. So let's get this thing rolled out onto the launch pad, as it were. The way that the Soviets did their rollouts, they had these whole things on trucks, rolling them out horizontally, laid down in flatbed trucks, assembled and then stood up on the launch pad. As opposed to Americans, which assembled the stuff sitting upright. Just a little bit of trivia there. I think I'm going to need to move this down just a bit. That's fine. All right, I'm going to check my staging here. These bottom guys are going to go off first. And these are going to separate. And then that's going to go off. Then the ignition of that engine. Which is the Munia rocket, the Lightning. It has an extra stage right here with an extra engine. So as soon as this stage gets us up and empties out, this is going to separate, obviously, and then this will continue to boost us up. And then this is the second block stage, a little engine here and a bit of fuel tanks here before the final. Now this guy I didn't put any propulsion on, so wherever this thing ends up going, he's gonna go. Okay, let's get this guy on the launch pad. We're going to launch him from our desert site. And why don't we... Hey. Be nice if that didn't minimize like that. Okay. So the first thing I'm going to do is launch this into some form of orbit. And then once it goes into orbit, then I have room to take the time to calculate my... Now, in real life, this would have been all done by... You know, with people with pencils and papers, calculating the math, checking their math, comparing their math, making sure that all of these things. Once I get, well, here, let me give a little example here. Let's make some of these lines disappear. We don't need these. We don't need that. So here is our planet. Here's where we are. Where we are on the planet. So going outward, there's the moon. And then you're going to see the sun that we are spinning around. And then in another orbit is this, which is Venus. Now, I believe I am in the proper... So, here's the deal. These things are spinning around the central point, which means the... It's you know, you don't really think about it right away, but these guys that are spinning, the ones that are closest to the middle... are actually spinning faster. Once you think about it, it's like, of course they are. Because they're taking less time, because we're talking about time and space, to move around their particular, well, to move around their space. Less time for the space equals faster. So they're in a faster orbit, technically. Well, actually... So what the amount of speed that's needed, my entire point here is the amount of speed needed to change your orbit from your Earth orbit, which is going around 95. So according to the game, the carbon planet here, which is our Earth, is going around 9,284.5 meters a second. Eve, our other planet, is going around 10,824 meters a second. So it's the faster orbit is just the closer in you are. It's just a matter of just mathematics. So what we actually need to do to get farther in, I talked about this last time, what we need to do in order to get closer to the sun is increase our energy a lot. Because we are already going at a particular speed. So any change that we make to our speed as a spacecraft or a rocket, any change that is got to be a great one, because right now we are sharing all of the velocity and speed and energy that exists in a planet that's circling around the sun at this particular speed. So anything we do relative to the sun, or that is relative to anything else that is also traveling at these great speeds around the sun, need to be taken into account. That's a lot of change. That's a lot of energy that needs to be exerted. And obviously that's energy that humans haven't been able to create up until recently. So let's get ourselves off the ground here. Sorry if that was very loud. All right, so I'm gonna tip this over. It's a little bit hard to keep stable. I've made the change where I changed made the main core body of this batter. If I don't mess it up. Loud. We still got some fuel in there. The problem where that when these boosters separate, there's a big explosion. I haven't solved that yet. So we're about to get a big... So those have cut off. Our four boosters are falling. Now I want to tip over because let me get into a nice stable little... Move to the larger view. Zoom in here. Again, here's us lifting off. Lifting off the... If we just look at it as a flat plane, we just have one ballistic arc coming up. All right, we've just... And again, our APWAPS is how high we are going to get with our current heading, with our current trajectory and current velocity. And that's rising the more we're adding speed. Adding speed per our fuel, per our direction that we're facing. So our ballistic arc, assuming we get enough speed and energy build up, our ballistic arc will go over the curve of the planet and our arc will become a circle and we will be in orbit. So let's make that happen. Talking way too much. Sky in orbit. It may be that the real one, the Venero one, not sure if they got into parking orbit first. They probably didn't. They probably just launched it straight up. Now, technically, I mean, I don't really need to go into parking orbit. If I were to weight it so that the planet is facing in the right direction, the right direction as of Venus, Eve, rather, this game. How far are we into orbit? Let's take a look. I'm going to wait till we get up to our APOAPS. So again, we're just still in a ballistic ascent. And once we get past the APOAPS, we will be in a ballistic free fall. Let's separate our stage. Bye-bye. Can open up this. Our probe is free for the open world. Here, let me not tempt fate. Let me just add a maneuver using my maneuver planner. So here we go. We're increasing the speed this direction when we get to this area. So you can see the arc is increasing until it goes around the curve of the planet. And now we have a new APOAPS, which is over here, and periaps is over here, and we're in a circle. And that is going to happen. This maneuver planner gives me a little blue thing right on our ball, our navigation ball, to tell me when to do this. And you can see the amount of burn time for the fuel is going to take 24 seconds. Let me activate this engine in the meanwhile. It's going to take a minute, so I can fast forward that to get to that spot around the planet. Remember, we're still in ballistic free fall while we're... Oh, I fast forward it way too much. I'm in too much ballistic free fall. I think I've screwed up. Let's just try to get into an orbit from where we're at right now. Right now I'm sinking. I'm in free fall. If I can't get myself into an orbit, I'm really in trouble. All right, looks like I can get into an orbit, but yeah, I'm in orbit right now, but I'm falling. All right, I'm leaving the... All right, at this point, my orbit is all messed up. As you can see, that maneuver... I did the maneuver way too late just because I fast-forwarded it. So let's see. So my orbit basically broke. I mean, it ceased becoming a circle. It got too much speed in one direction, and it broke, and it's just flinging me out. into this direction. Now, technically, in order to successfully do this, all I need to do is to get it to intercept with Eve, which I know it's in a transfer window. Uh-oh, what just happened there? All right, I'm going to have to. It's re-entering the atmosphere. So this... Oh, dear. So this wasn't actually Venera 1. This was just... this was Venera XK. XKZ1. That's what this was. Which is... that's what the Soviets did. When they had a launch, they generally didn't... It's okay. We'll just go straight back to launch. That's quite all right. This time I won't spend too much time yapping about it, and I'll just get it done. Let's see. We've already got... Well, I'm not looking at how long we've been going so far. They would usually only announce it to the public after it was successful. So... Now, during the time, so I'll just talk about 1961. During the time of here, like I'd mentioned, there were lots of there were about 60 launches of spacecraft in 1961 throughout that year. A large portion of them were more polar spy satellites sent by the Americans and recovered. I thought about doing one of those if I had time. I know there were a couple that I didn't successfully do in the 1960 video that I did. Yeah, we're coming up on our... I don't know why I enjoy that. So some other stuff during the time of 1961, 1961 really started to become a tumultuous year, when it came down to it. A lot of it sort of started in, we had the United Nations, trying to do its thing. However, in Africa, you had lots of unrest happening. After World War II, you seem to have had the British Empire, along with some other nations, Belgium and basically all these European colonialists, seem to be loosening their grip on their colonies, on these other countries, and giving them a modicum of freedom. However, still, some would argue, keeping them in economic servitude in some way. Everything is just to make money, and that's where you have the traditional capitalista versus communistic viewpoint of the world. So it's where a lot of this stuff really started to get heated. And you can look around and you can try to make determinations about individuals on whether or not they were fully wrapped up in communist ideology or fully wrapped up into, whatever. I mean, that's the thing. A lot of the communist ideology is tied hand to toe with an idea of collectivism. And I would also say atheism, where about the other views are generally viewed as also religious nutcases and that sort of thing. Obviously there's a, people try to find a happy medium in between. Are we even in orbit right now? What have we been doing here? Let's check it out. We've got a nice ballistic arc going up to 100 miles. Let's get rid of these other markers. So again, once we get up to this, let me do it a little bit before. We're going to increase that. There we go. 1 minute and 35. We're done with this rocket. Goodbye. That guy will burn back up in the atmosphere. So as it were, the country of the Congo, which it was once freed from European colonial ship, you know, that, for example, it's one example, almost one microcosm of what's going on, attempt to be free, a person attempt to become a ruler of determine this country in a sovereign way. However, interferences from the outside people, and you know, for example, the man Patrice Lumumba, he became a popular leader of his country, and then there were different factions, which you could say different factions, which were controlled and arbitrated by communists or by Americans. That's the thing. People won't like to point their finger. It's a matter of who you decide to trust to give you advice, to help you with your country. Personally, as a Christian who believes that there is a God, I wouldn't trust any atheistic society, any society that, or form of society that would tell you that human beings are the ones that decide what's right and wrong versus God above. So I've just achieved orbit. That's what I didn't successfully do before. So taking a look, our little arc has now expanded out to become a circle. 139 by 97 miles circle around the planet. So now I'm going to look at the going all the way out into excuse me. Hey, what's up, Jim? Good to see you, man. If we look out on our solar system, so I at our planet here, I'm in a circle around it. So what I'm going to do is plan a maneuver to bounce out of that circle. So again, from one side of the circle, from one side of the orbit, I'm going to increase the speed a lot. And then the other side of that circle is going to bulge out because of the speed that I'm increasing from the other side. I'm just going to demonstrate. Actually, here's another satellite I already did that with. Zero. But I may just disappear. Let's turn that off. So our green circle is our current orbit right now. So I'm going to add a maneuver. Now I can change when the maneuver happens. So that's why I'm being kind of just wherever. So let's increase. And the idea is to... So as I'm doing this, what this is actually doing is circling when I do my maneuver around the orbit. So when in my orbit am I going to do this maneuver? Because when it is in relation to the other side of the sun really matters. Or, I mean, the other side of the planet. The idea is to do it with as least energy as possible. And, yeah, to match up with this. So let me set Venus here, or Eve, as a target. And I don't really have a time limit on how long to... I'm in an orbit now of my spacecraft, so it's just going to keep going until... Well, it could run out of electricity. There we go. Up here, if you see these two little flags, that's showing where Venus is going to be and where my spacecraft is going to be in relation to the course that I'm plotting right here. So as I'm moving this around... And now they just disappear, which means they're not going to be in any... Oopsie. All right, this is getting... Let's add another one. Ah, I keep accidentally hitting the thing. Let's add a maneuver. So I believe... See, that's a 15-second burn. That gets me nowhere. Try a 20-second burn. 20-second burn at farthest would get me out past Mars. But again, I'm going inward. as I'm burning inward, which means I'm going against the sun, which means I'm technically slowing myself down. That's very strange. the math is so. You can quote me on this. Math is crazy. Because we need to shrink our orbit. So you can see the green here is the orbit of the sun. I mean, I'm sorry, the orbit of the Earth around the sun. What's yellow is our target orbit, but we're not going to match the orbit of Venus itself. All we're trying to do is pass it. So this is where our orbit, as we shrink our own orbit, our orbit is going to deviate from that, which was the orbit of the Earth. And we're just trying to pass to the point where we're passing this one object, the planet Venus. And we're almost there. See, I can see where we're getting close. I might want to just wait until I'm out of the... Yeah. Apologize for the deadness. Come on. So I've estimated about a 20-some second burn. It should be all that it takes with this engine. As you can see, oh boy. Trying to plot this so that... All right, I think I'm going to leave it there so that we can at least get out of the orbit. So in 17 minutes, although I'm going to fast forward to that, we're going to do a maneuver burn. You know what? I'm just going to save it. I don't want to have to redo this and waste a lot of time. I think I may have fast forward a few more weeks in the game for the planet to actually be, but I shouldn't have an issue. Shouldn't have an issue with just doing a bypass. It's not like I'm trying to orbit it. So if I was trying to orbit that other planet, I would also have to have enough fuel and engine stuff in order to slow down to match up with the speed of the planet. Because right now I'm just going in a whole different speed of the planet itself. So I'm just facing this through one direction. As you can see, my nice circular orbit is becoming an oval shape. I'm over here and I'm shooting off in this direction as soon as I get there. All this is doing is adding to my ballistic trajectory. There we go. I'm going to match up with, once it stops in one particular area, we're shutting off the engine. Now that's it. I am out of Earth orbit, and you can see the what was once a circle has now become pretty much a line, because I've boosted my speed, I've boosted my energy, and now we are going out into outer space. I am going to do a course correction. I definitely need to do a course correction. I'm wondering if the moons were getting in my way. can see the electricity is drastically going down. It probably go down before I get there, so I think I'm going to have to somehow shut down the entire spacecraft so I can, or just activate the electricity cheat, which I don't want to do. Let's hibernate in warp. Hey, how about that? There's another probe core on here that I'm going to tell to hibernate in warp. So I think we should be able to... Let's test it. Yeah. Now, just because I messed up and that first one didn't go, because I should have been able to do that from the get-go. Like, right now, you can see how far away from the planet I'm getting to do a correction burn. Generally, I should be capable, if I wasn't so inept, I should be capable of doing the math properly to... If I did the rocket science, right? I should be capable of doing this to where that's going to give me a flyby of that other planet from my first initial burn. I just did that large burn, and I'm going in the general direction. However, I'm in no way doing a flyby of the planet yet. I'm about to do a... I mean, you can see I'm getting pretty close to it. However, I'm still going to be separated by like 2 million kilometers. Or 328, like 3 million. So that's still pretty far from it. So I am going to do a correction burn, which shouldn't be as much, to at least get me doing a flyby. And then I think I actually am going to show the other planet, because we can see there's our little Earth. Here goes our moon, really far away. Now that we are leaving their neighborhood, because probably in real life, they did the whole burn already, and they would have separated the spacecraft. Although, it's hard to say. But just because Venera 1, I know Venera 1 often captures my imagination, just because it is kind of the first time we've, like, it's so early, but yet we sent this man-made thing so far, and we're able to do it to where this point in the sky that we've always seen all throughout of history, Venus, which, you know, some would argue maybe is a little more mysterious than the moon, because the moon, we can kind of see that it has texture, it has these shapes, it is a place, but Venus is sort of this rising light that now we've sent this thing there. The one thing I'm noticing up here on the left, you're showing our radio signal. Now, I did pack this thing full of antennas and stuff and radios, so I don't think we should have a problem. I mean, I will activate a cheat if I need to actually complete the mission at this point. Just because, again, my goal here is to demonstrate sort of just the basic physics of this stuff, not the engineering. So we are leaving the Earth and Moon system, and because again, we've created enough energy in enough particular trajectory in to completely go against that spinning Earth. Now, the entire time, we're still spinning around the Sun. We're still in orbit around the Sun. All we're doing now is adjusting our orbit as it is around the Sun, just like we were just orbiting around the Earth. Now, because we are free of Earth orbit, we're orbiting around the Sun, because everything in the solar system is orbiting around the Sun. All right, so now we're out here in free, what's called heliocentric orbit. So I'm going to try to adjust. All right. So if I just add a maneuver going along this sense. Oh, there we go. As you can see, these flags up here, they're showing where my spacecraft and where the planet is, because the planet is a target. So right there, you can see they're coming together. Boom. And I will just fast forward it. Now, there's a mod that you can get that'll just be like, oh, intersect these things, which maybe I should just do that. for the sake of not having a lot of boring empty space in the video. So anyway, let me make my maneuver node. To where I'm intersecting this planet. And it doesn't have to be close, so let me stop being really. Hey, look at that. We're going to be within 40. So this would intersect this planet. So here's the planet. Now it gives me a periapsis of that other planet. Let's see what periapsis, or how far away it got from Venus. 62,000 miles flyby. That's crazy. So let's see, what can I do to adjust this? Let's see, that's 49 million. 30 million. 26, hey. 26, it's still going. So I think right now we're going back to 32. All right, we're at 36 again. 70. All right, we're decreasing. I'm just going to start making the slightest of adjustments. 10. Okay, looking good. 16. Now we got to go back. There, we're at 8 million now. Whoop. Did that give us an actual? So 8 million. 7 million. Adjust these a little. 7 million 36. Nope. Because there's going to be a sweet spot. 7 million 4. Seven million 2. 4 million 3. 2, 1. All right, we're getting within under a million. 500. Oh, look at that. Looks like we might be hitting the planet. That'd be too good. Let's adjust this out a bit. I don't want to do that, actually. That'd be fun, but... Whoopsie. Where'd our periapsis go? Closest approach... 85... 500. Alright, what did I say we got close enough to? 62,000. So this is 500,000. So if we can get any closer, that would be amazing. And I'm actually going to do that. So we're at 500,000. That's as close as we're going to get. See if I poke that in there. 300,000. That makes my periapsis disappear from the actual planet itself, or I'm so close to it. I don't like that. Let's see, closest approach 80,000. I'm just gonna do it. I'm gonna do that burn. Let's see what happens. That burns in 5 hours. We're going to fast forward to it. And we're in hibernation mode on this spacecraft. Oh, I forgot. This spacecraft has solar panels. I have solar panels on this spacecraft. So, again, we're still on top of... Oh, you know, I still have a whole separate engine. We are fine on engines. on fuel. We're going to do this. We're going to make this. Within 62,000 miles, that's 100,000 kilometers, flyby of Venus. It took 311 days to do it. Let's do a little bit of a correction burn here. Now this is altering, because again, all of this stuff mathematically can be plotted, because where I am, there's a direction that I'm heading, and the speed that I'm heading in that direction. And since we're in space, there's nothing that's going to stop me from heading in that direction. That's why all of this mathematically can be plotted or predicted. All about predictability. Oh, and all right, now, as you can see, this green area. Now, this is showing my apoapsis of the sun, how far away from my sun versus my periapsis of the sun, which is how far away I'm getting from the sun. At this moment, I'm going to get very close to the planet Venus. I'm trying to see how close this is claiming I'm going to get. We're still at 5 million. That's disappointing. Well, you know what I'm going to do? Because I have a whole other rocket engine, I'm going to utilize. We're going to separate this, and it's going to give us more precise. I totally forgot about that. We're going to get more precise kick, because we have an extra kick engine here. So let's decouple that. Now we're right with our main probe and our little solar panels. These are going to look kind of silly, but I don't have anything that truly equals what the original one looked like on Venera 1. Venera 1 had two kind of butterfly wing looking. Now, I should have only put one. Right, anyway, let's activate that engine. Chickity-chunga. All right, and let's get a maneuver happening. Just to get us, again, I'm just trying to adjust our as close as we can get to the planet. So it looks cool when we fly by it. And this is really... I know I had it close. I had it pretty good, didn't I? This is getting kind of... We're gonna get something here. There's 6, 4. Two point six. 2.8. I'm not gonna take too much longer, because again, as long as we have a nice view of this thing, I think we're good. They were in 300,000 kilometers, 177,000 kilometers. Now that just went back a lot. we're in the ballpark. We're close. 500,000. That's really close, because again, that 500,000, that's if like right, like our standard orbit that we're going up into space is about 70 kilometers in this game. So this would take us 200,000 kilometers from the surface of this planet. So we'd be pretty far away from it. But now again, in real life, we went, let's see, that's 500 kilometers. You know what? Let's do that. Let's do it. That burn is so slow. It's 0.1 second of a burn. That's how precise we need to get in with this. This is where I really should, I really should have put those really tiny engines on here. So anyway, let's fast forward to 4 days in the game, which we're doing right now. It's going to fast forward us to when we need to do this little 0.0 second burn. Wow. It's so precise. It's just crazy. All right. It's telling me 49 seconds. It's really tiny burn. And this is as much as I'm going to do with it. Trying to be just as precise as possible. Oh, they're already going out. All right, let's see what we've done with those little puffs of burnings of engines. Closest approach, 500. That's not bad. So, just for realism's sake, I'm going to decouple this section of the rocket. We can't move anymore. No more maneuvers. We're passing this planet. And that's all there is to it. No, we have an even counter. Did that just knock me into the planet? You know what? We're going to find out. We just spent that long. And then the next thing we're going to do after this is going to be the human in space. All right, so I'm going to fast forward this to the planet. We're going to get as close as we can to Eve. And this is our viewing of Venera 1. Or in the game Eve. So I'm fast forwarding a lot. Until this probe is going to basically catch up with Eve over here. And you can see it, because again, here's where it's going to be. Here's where the planet currently is. Interesting. I just did all this fast forwarding. If there are any more Venus probes, well, I'll just have to fast forward it again. The next transfer window. So I want to do this. All right, so let's go. You can see we're getting closer and closer to the planet, and something's about to happen there. Here's our little probe. Still can't see Venus yet. Oh man, what is that? Oh, I hate when I do that. So zoom in a lot. Oh. This is actually going to hit the planet. That's kind of amazing. You know what? Let's do it. I didn't really mean for that to happen. You know what? Maybe it happened in real life. They didn't know. They lost contact with the thing. Now, mathematically, they would have been a little more precise, so they would have been aware. So I've just been fast forwarding into the game by a lot, by 144 days. So here you can look off, you can see the planet. So let's fast forward more. And we're going to see that guy getting closer. Look at that. Let's not go too fast. So we've just flung this probe all the way across the solar system. There it is. There's another planet. We have gone far enough to go near this other planet. Still too not close enough to the sun is blocking any good view of it. And yeah, our orbit's not gonna I really shouldn't have detached that rocket from it. Because, yeah, we're going to crash into this guy. Again, the crashing into the planet is not historically accurate. But they lost contact with it. We're going to have lots of more adventures on Venus, but... Oh, yeah. Venus has a... And Eve, this planet here, has a very thick atmosphere. Most things you try to enter the atmosphere with it are going to explode anyway. it's a lot of clouds, etc. Actually, I do kind of, I want you to have a Venera probe circling around. So, I am going to preserve this thing. So, I just reloaded it back to just before I crashed it into the planet. And I'm going to redo it again. In order to... But I'm not going to do that live. So let me put an end to this. Although, let me get this thing out of our orbit again, really quickly. Fast forward a few minutes to do that, so I can just have this in free fall while I go back and while we're going to launch Vostok. So again, in this year, 1961, so President Eisenhower stepped down from being president. John F. Kennedy became president there. A lot of stuff happening with Cuba. America said, we're not going to do deals with Cuba. We also had what's called the Bay of Pigs incident. The Bay of Pigs happened. And which was a failed attempt at Americans to assassinate Fidel Castro. Again, as I said, also lots of United Nations stuff. Let me just make sure this isn't going to crash into the moon or something. Okay, great. Good old Venera. All right, we're going to return to the Space Center. And we are going to do Vostok. So, just as a bit of a review, there was something called the space race. And the Americans and the Soviets, their first, the first thing you need to do is make sure that a human being can survive in space. Is this it? Did I do it? The Woodstock? I just called it Woodstock just because I'm not very clever. This should look familiar. This launch vehicle, it's similar to the Mulyanya rocket, which is just like a larger version. It has the actual Mulyanea had an extra stage, as we just saw demonstrated on the Venera probe. This doesn't have an extra stage. This only has the block stage up here. Block stage being this, you can see the extra engine below, which will detach itself. And then our Vostok craft itself. Well, so I did send several tests. And now, as we know, the Soviets, they used dogs and stuff to test these things. They did have successful tests in returning these probes back to Earth. We've got some parachutes, etc. The Americans at this time, and actually even in the time of, you know what, let's get Yuri, our pilot. He's going to go in there. I'm going to check our station. We got these guys are going to go off. We got this is going to go off. This is going to separate. Oh, no, we want big engine to go off after this separates. This is going to separate. We need the shroud opening. Sorry. Shroud opening. This engine going off. Shroud needs to open before the engine goes off. So shroud opening. Shroud should probably open before that even separates. All right, those two, that's going to separate. And then Mr. Engine, do I have another? Yes. This this needs to separate. And this needs to separate. All right, we're going to have our probe. So this is going to be our first manned flight. So again, the Americans at this point, the Americans this year in 1961 did start sending higher primates into space in their Mercury capsules. Again, Americans really tried to, they wanted to play it safe. The pilots, I would say if it wasn't for the astronauts, if it wasn't for, if the people listened to those seven astronauts, Alan Shepard, John Glenn, Buzz Aldrin was amongst them. I'll get into that once we do Mercury. But yeah, they would have won because they would have. It seemed that they highly resented the monkeys being sent into space. Gus Grissom was another one. Those guys were brave. They would have said, just send me right now. But no, the Americans wanted to play it safe. Meanwhile, the Soviets are sending just people straight up. Let's get this guy on the launch pad. All right. Oh, it's getting dark. I'm kind of curious on when Yuri's flight was. Do I want to save it for the morning? Now, Yuri Gagarin's flight lasted 1 hour and 48 minutes. It's like he only went into about an orbit. We'll get into it once we actually do this. Whoops. And I am going to step away for a quick moment. I'm kind of curious what time of day, 6:07 UTC time. Not sure what that means. but I'm imagining that means pretty early in the morning. I'm going to try to warp to sunrise. Hopefully we don't run out of electricity. No, we don't. Good. Yeah, so we've got a morning launch. Yeah, he's gonna get our astronaut, our cosmonaut rather, is getting ready.
The pretty face belongs to relief power, no relief letdown. When you catch a cold, your head fills up. Tablets give some relief, but soon wear off. Between doses, your head fills up again. But take just one Contact capsule. Your head clears fast, stays clear. Contact relieves all day. Contact relieves all night. Only Contact contains tiny time pills scientifically set like clocks. Some dissolve fast, relieve fast. The rest dissolve hour by hour as your system needs them. Relieve your cold up to 12 hours. Contact's unique medical formula with special drying agent dries runny nose, stops sneezing, clears nasal passages as no tablet does. New Contact, 12-hour relief power over head cold congestion. Contact.
Ladies, ditch your husbands.
Well, not really. But if he's talking about buying any compact car but a Lark, leave him at home and see your Studebaker dealer yourself. Look at the Lark's roomy, stylish interiors. The built-in comfort. Learn about the economies of gas, maintenance, and repair. Get behind the wheel. Test drive the Lark for ease of handling. Then go home and save your family from possible disaster. Make him see your Studebaker dealer about a 61 Lark.
See Mr. Ed again next week. And meanwhile, say hello to your Studebaker dealer who invites you to compare, test drive the most exciting compact in America today, the Lark by Studebaker.
Mr. Ed is brought to you by New Handy Wrap. The clear new sandwich wrap in the 100-foot roll, economically priced like wax paper.
Not again.
What's wrong?
Something leaked. It's the pickle.
This pickle didn't leak.
How come?
Grace found this new clear stuff to wrap lunches in. Won't leak. Sandwiches taste better, too. Don't dry out.
That's right. Clear new handy wrap won't leak. Handy Wrap does make sandwiches taste better. Handy Wrap really locks in freshness. Watch. I'm pouring scalding hot coffee into this cup lined with Handy Wrap. Imagine what would happen to ordinary sandwich wrap. But with Handy Wrap, there's not a hint of a leak. Handy Wrap locks in freshness. Keeps sandwiches so fresh you can make them the night before. Giant 100-foot roll. wraps 100 sandwiches, yet Handy Wrap is economically priced like wax paper. Yes, you get 100 feet of Handy Wrap economically priced like wax paper.
Handy Wrap, product of the Dow Chemical Company. Today, Studebaker offers you many quality products. Here's one.
I'm Art Baker, and I've been trying a test. When I dip this screwdriver in oil, I can hold it by its tip. But just as soon as I add STP, look what happens. STP, the oil concentrate, has made the screwdriver so slippery I can't hold it. That's how STP works, to cut engine friction to almost nothing to give you more power. Add a can of STP to your oil. You'll immediately notice the difference in your car's performance.
Also from Studebaker, when the Gravely tractor is your power partner, you get the tough jobs done fast. Gravely powers 30 quickly interchangeable attachments, a tool for every job, every season. All-gear drive and unique lugging power gets the work done fast, whether it's plowing, cultivating, mowing, or moving snow. Enjoy the satisfaction of owning the best. See for yourself at your Gravely sales and service dealer. Studebaker, quality maker of quality products for 109 years.
To you by your friendly Studebaker dealer, who hopes you'll enjoy the show and invite you to come in and test drive the fine new 60.
Allow me, comrades, to inform our Soviet government, our Communist Party, and all the. Allow me, comrades, to inform our Soviet government, our Communist Party, and all the Soviet people that I accept with honor the task assigned to me to open the first path into space. And if during the execution of this assignment I encountered any difficulties, I shall overcome them as the communists do.
First man in space, it was the dream. But
greetings, greetings. I apologize for that hiatus. Those are actually some vintage commercials from 1961. I heard something about Mr. Ed. I always remember 1959 was Mr. Ed. It's amazing how quickly things happen. As I mentioned, this year alone had about over 60 some spacecraft launched in orbit from this 1961 versus 1958, which is the first time something went into orbit. So from 1958 to 1961, it was just a revolution of space flight. So here's our little dude, Yuri Kerman. There's a way to go in and truly like customize these guys. You can give them goatees and mullets and stuff. Again, I'm trying to keep it vanilla here. Can I see them if I look at that? Alrighty, so our goal here is to get in orbit and to leave orbit alive with our little dude to keep alive. And the famous words of Yuri Gagarin. How do I say it in Russian? Let's go. Поехали. I don't know how to say it. Поехали. Oh, how embarrassing. I should have learned how to say that. I probably would have just embarrassed myself more by trying to say it. But he yelled, "Let's go." Just like any other orbital craft. Now we are going to put this guy. Now, another thing is, Soviets, they, that their orbit, their standard orbit, wasn't the same as the American standard orbit. I'm not sure exactly what they were, but the generally the object is you want to orbit as close to the equator as possible. But the other thing, and this is something that this game does not include, is that the Earth is orbiting at an angle, so your orbit in real life is going to have to be at an angle. Here we go, separation. Ooh, I really got to fix that. There goes our boosters. All right. Going up and up. Our little dude's still happy. I tip this over. There's no more air pressure, there's no more molecules, so the shroud can go. Take a look at our Perry apps and our Apo apps. Our Apo apps is as high as we're going to get. Right now, we're going to get up to 115. We're still rising. But because I'm tipped over this much, our Perry apps is what needs to increase. We take a look at our ballistic arc is moving along nicely. Again, that arc is going to become a circle, and then that becomes our orbit. I try to keep the Apo apps fairly low. Otherwise, it becomes a huge bulge and a huge elliptical orbit. However, this is my speed ever increasing. I'm not slowing down at any point during this. So here comes our orbit. We're getting it. Check it out. There's our circle, which is our orbit. So we're in a 294 by 30. We're still not in orbit yet. Whoopsie. Whoops. Good to see you, Wins. So I need to increase our orbit, or because we need to be at least 70 meters high, or in the, I like to say in this game, it's miles, because there's no real scale in this game. So 70 miles. Because right now we're 294 by 30. So once we get back around, so we're still going up high. So we're still in a free fall, although we're falling upward, as it were, because we've just propelled ourselves. So now we are slowing down because our rocket engine stopped. I could ignite this. This is our second stage. Take a look at our dude inside of here. He's doing all right. But really, I should be, for realism's sake, I should really be just igniting this. So let's just make sure I can. Well, I'm kind of curious on what Yuri's actual orbit was. But let me make sure I get myself into a stable orbit right now. So that 8-second burn at that spot will make my periaps will increase. And now I'll have a stable orbit. So let's do that with our final, and that'll be our final rocket stage, because really we're not supposed to leave this attached so much. This is supposed to do its final burn, but I just want to make sure that this is happening successfully. So let's get to when we're going to ignite the engine. So we're going to fast forward. There goes our other spot. There's our old rocket. Point this in the correct trajectory. That engine. They give us a burn. Bye-bye, old rocket booster. And whoops, we got to stop it. All right. Now we're in orbit. 150 by 290, 295. We're in a stable orbit. Now I want to adjust. All right, so check it out. For the sake of, so we're going to get rid of this booster. Ooh, nice. Now, so this is the first Vostok. Well, it's my puny version of it. So this dude, I could have done the entire flight from inside of this craft. I've done it before, an older game, and just only use the navigational ball. So if I camera, because now I'm at the point of view of my little guy, and there's the lower part. So if I spin, oops. Uh-oh, I'm really... I'm getting myself out of control. There we go. All right. So yeah, and you can see there's the little the hatch, which they had a one little kind of viewport here. So yeah, he only stayed up for a single orbit. Yuri Gagarin. Yeah. Okay, so how do we get down? So we got to get this guy back down from space. Can't stay up here. Alrighty. So going back to our space view. Let me see if I can turn that down a little bit. Okay, going back to our... I don't like it, does that? Now, we see our orbit. It's a little bit... It's not quite a perfect circular orbit. Now, I want to try to be realistic and land us on land. Yuri landed. He actually landed out in a farm, in a farmland. I mean, that's most of Russia, right? And some random people. I mean, most people didn't have radios. I mean, I believe in the USSR, a lot of the farmers and stuff at that time like didn't really have a lot of information happening, so they probably didn't even realize what space was and what people were doing in it or with it. So we're gonna go into a single orbit. Let's see, can we do this? Here's what I'm gonna do. My burn is, well, this is really rocking, but I can't make it that low. So here's my maneuver, which is basically going to turn around and burn my engine in this in the other direction, as you can see, it's going to shrink my orbit by that direction. Now, actually, I want to do this. I want to have it happen during the in a daylight side, because I could choose if I did it over here, for example, and burn my orbit. I'm not in a perfect, but it would go down over here. And might see where my direction out of it. Now I'm in a free fall hitting that area. But if I do this retro burn over here, now because over here is in a higher altitude, it's going to take more. But I should have enough. So like I said, I want to land in daylight, and I also want to land on the land. So let me make sure I do this right. Adding maneuver, that's 32 minutes from now. That's going to take us... This might be the worst place to do it, but I need to make sure it hits land. I mean, to do it in order to conserve fuel, but I think we're okay if we do it here. It should take us down in the desert, which is exactly what we want. So the true flights, as I was saying, from Russia and from Kazakhstan, they were never true. In order to get a perfect equatorial flight, it wasn't necessarily easy. So there's always inclinations happening. And again, the planet in itself is a 33 degree or 29 or something, 22.9 degree in, or you know what? I don't even remember. It's not exactly perfect. It wobbles, basically, is what I'm trying to say. Okay, so our little dude is in orbit. So this thing had the back of it had the main retro rocket, which is what we're going to burn in order to decrease our orbital speed. The other fuel that this thing used was actually hydrogen peroxide. It was just a single, it didn't really ignite, it wasn't like a flame to putting it to hairspray. It was just kind of this puffed out of these things, which is called a RCS. You can see the reaction control system thrusters. So those are usually a separate system from the main retro rocket. And yeah, I don't really have these set up properly because I don't have any set up to roll. I must have forgot to add that part. I still have a reaction control gyroscope wheels. Forgot what they're called. but that's why I'm actually able to roll right here without the thrusters. So 35 minutes of circling this planet, which I'm going to fast forward up into that point, and we're going to, this guy, I have no reason to think he's not going to survive. I've already done test flights. So yeah, I know this is already going pretty long, but I've started to just, I need to make these shorter and more to the point. So we are now where? Oh yeah, so I've done other test flights of this spacecraft elsewhere. No Kerbals were harmed, but I can't say the same thing for little green dogs that don't actually exist. So don't worry. Oh yeah, I forgot to extend these antennas because they look cool. Little Soviet space car. It's a little Soviet Lada. We're gonna log some temperatures. Well, we know it doesn't actually, there is no temperature in space because there's nothing in space to be having a temperature. the thermometer would be measuring itself based on whatever particles are hitting it and what those particles are doing with it. Yeah. Oh, yeah. We need the face in the proper alignment. Activate our retro engine. As you can see, our orbit should be decreasing. Our green orbit is shrinking now. Our periaps, 60. It's going down into the planet. And we're slowing ourselves down. Essentially, we're facing backwards right now. Oh no, did I just do what I didn't want to do and go in at night? How much fuel do I have left? I want to go in during the daytime. I totally have it, had it backwards. I was thinking I was going in the wrong, oh man, I'm so stupid. I was going in the wrong direction. Because right here I would have landed in the desert, but I'm actually going in this direction. Right. Yeah, because that's negative 32 minutes and that's negative 3 minutes. Well, not sure if he did. He can just re-maneuver. That's another 28 seconds of maneuvers. Why not? I mean, he did maneuvers up there. Let's re-maneuver ourselves. Go back. We have enough fuel. All right, we're back in orbit. Okay. So I've just added to where we've raised our periaps up to 80. Which means... All right, so we're going to do our burn on the other side. Yeah, we should be doing it. If we want to decrease it, our orbit on the day side, we're going to need to do it on the other side, which is going to be the night side, essentially. So it's going to take considerably... We have enough fuel to do this. It's close. Yeah, we definitely have enough fuel. We have plenty of fuel to do this. To make sure we land in the desert in the daytime. All right. Why is this so difficult here? It's not rocket science, right? Yar, yar, yar. I think this is a good, this is a real flat angle. That'll take us really shallow. It might burn us up because we're going to spend so much time in the atmosphere. Let's see if we can take it down more. 39 seconds, that's a lot. By the time it gets even beyond that, it's going to... Because it's kind of difficult to predict it. Because once it hits the atmosphere, it's going to start moving some weird ways. All right, this... What is that? That's... 87, which means this is, see, I do not want it to go down too soon. Ooh, That's perfect. This is going to be a really shallow angle. Okay, we're going to do it this. When we're 100 meters, 100 kilometers up, rather, or 118. So we're going to be, which is in 15 minutes. All right, when the top of our orbit, which is going to be 100 and... Right now we're at 250. We're at 250. We're just going to pretend that the meters are the same thing as miles in this weird Kerbal world and say we're 250 miles up. When we get to 250, we're going to pull off our retro burn. And that's going to take us really... Now, this actual spacecraft, the lander, is made of the ablator. So they invented this ablation material that basically burns away as it's falling through the atmosphere. Because again, as it's falling through the atmosphere, it is it's generating so much heat. Because obviously you're having particles at high speeds hitting other particles at high speeds. And all particles are, as we understand them, are made up of other particles that are interacting with each other, electrons and protons and neutrons. And when you have something falling through the atmosphere, because again, right now it looks like we're just being very, very slow. It looks like you can't even tell how slow this thing is going. I mean, how fast it's going. But indeed, this thing is, according to even in this game, it's 2,000 meters a second. In real life, orbital speed is about something like 19,000 miles an hour or 17,000 miles. It's something ridiculous. That's at a constant speed. But because you're in space, it's hard to imagine. That's why if you were to just simply climb a tower into space, for example, you wouldn't just be able to let go and then just float away into space. You're still being affected by gravity. The reason why this thing is staying in space is because it's in orbit, which means it's built up enough energy in order to be in motion. And the speed of its motion is giving it the force and energy to stay in motion around the planet, because there's nothing to stop it. Just physics. So it's just staying in this constant speed, never slowing down. All right, let's fast forward to our maneuver. And oh, we're already facing it. All right, we're there. We are now in our circle of an orbit. As we've turned around, we've slowed ourselves down by basically putting our engine in front of us and burning at speed, and then turned our orbit, which, remember, all the orbit is the predicted path of the circle around of which you're traveling. We've shrunk it down again to where part of it is going within the thing we're orbiting around, otherwise known as a arc or a ballistic arc, or just free fall, or falling now into the planet. Now at some point we're going to hit the atmosphere. We need to separate and we need to activate our parachutes. Again, this spacecraft is in two stages. The main engineering stage, and then the pilot stage. I forget the official names for them at the moment. I'm sorry. And the correct time to separate these. Now, again, it was considered classified information, top secret at the time, but the pilot didn't actually land with the craft. The pilot did about 10 miles up, I believe, or 7 miles up, separate from the craft. Maybe it was 5. I don't remember now. he separated himself from the craft. He exited it and then landed on his own parachute. And as I said, a farm woman and her daughter saw him landing, and he wearing this bright orange suit, and kind of freaked them out because they were just like, what's going on here? And apparently this Yuri Gagarin, who had this great smile, was just like, no, it's great. I'm speaking Russian like you. And the grandmother tried to like run, and the little girl was like, no, he's speaking Russian. So we're going to have to separate this shortly. I'm going to wait a bit. Separation and the parachute. I guess I might as well do the parachutes now. I don't quite remember, because if I do the parachute, it's not like it's going to activate the parachutes, because I'm going to tell the parachutes to activate at about a kilometer up. And this is just the parachutes on this spacecraft. Interesting. Because I am going to try to have him exit the spacecraft as he is leaving. So I'm still going to set these parachutes. Well, it shouldn't really matter. I'm going to have him still exit the thing and leave it 7 miles up. I'm going to set these parachutes to go off at the altitude of, we'll just say 2 miles or two kilometers on this. I know kilometers aren't the same as a mile. Again, I keep interchanging them because in this game, it's kind of just bizarre. Oh, and we are slowly falling around the planet. As I'm sitting here just yapping away. And let's take a look back at our trajectory. We've just passed our apoaps and we're landing. So let me just get this done. See, I want to wait till I'm... All right, so let's fast forward this. If you can just imagine that we're in the arc, we can see the arc. It's happening. If you look at it like as a plane. And we're going to come in pretty steep. Now, it looks like we're going to hit the water or right above the water. But what I think is going to happen, what I hope is going to happen is when we hit the atmosphere, it's going to slow us down drastically. And this arc is actually going to shrink even more so that we are going to come down in the desert. So that's why I've plotted the course that way. So let's hope. And that's why I'm staying detached up until the very last moment. Because I think if I just detach it, I'm not exactly sure how it's going to change it up. We shouldn't change it up by that much. But I'm going to detach it as soon as we start hitting the upper atmosphere. Which we're about almost 80 miles up and shrinking. And our little dude And make sure we're controlling the vessel from there. I don't even know if I can. I don't think I can even control it once I separate it. So I should just face it backwards just in case. Although, if I do it this way, it's going to stay stuck together. Let's unbackwards it a little bit. No, I have a pilot in here. Oh, what's going on? There he goes. Where are you going? All right, there we go. Let's separate back. Get back with this dude. All right, so I'm in my little ball. Hopefully these are indeed activated. Disarm. Yeah, so these are armed. I've always increased the pressure on those guys. But again, the plan is that my little... Oh, he's... I don't know if that's screaming in joy or screaming in horror. Where's the other part of the ship? Because on the other one, I believe I put a probe core. There should be... I should be able to... Well, once it's separated, there really isn't a decent way to control this. But I should actually... I'm attempting to make it a little bit more primitive so that as I start creating the more up-to-date ones... Oh, here we go. As I start creating the more up-to-date ones, they're a little easier to control. I imagine some things on here. Those antennas are probably going to get burnt up. Although, you know, that's gonna serve to cool it down, that little wobble. It's going to transfer some of the heat, at least. So again, this isn't friction. This is the particles, the air particles being squeezed in front of it. They can't get out of the way fast enough. So the very electrons or the very not electrons, protons are being I believe protons are being squeezed out of the atom. Or no, it is electrons. Otherwise, if it feels protons, I think it would be like a nuclear explosion. But I know it's technically not friction. All right, so it's good. He survived this. He did not burn up in the atmosphere, as we've seen other spacecraft that have come in. And that was a very, very steep angle. So it looks like we are indeed over the desert. Take a look. Yeah, see how arc shrank big time. Hey, what's going on there? 20,000. Why do those go off? Oh, they must be set to go off at certain pressure also. Hey, what's up, Nanya man? Mike, I believe. Yeah, so for some reason, two of these parachutes just went off. The other one didn't. I'm falling drastically. I'm 12 miles up now above the desert. At about 7, this dude is going to bail out. And he should have his own parachutes. If he doesn't, there's no reason he shouldn't. We're at 9. Time to bail out pretty soon. Well, let's get out of here. Yeah, we have a parachute. We're good. All right. How long do we wait? We're at about 6. Well, see you later. I guess that thing's going to hit before us. I guess we have more. Our pressure. That's interesting why that would happen. Well, the heck on those parachutes wouldn't be going off. There's no more control on this. I didn't put a probe in that. That's unfortunate. There they go. And here comes my chutes. There we go. Almost worried it wouldn't happen for some reason. And that guy up there. Okay, so that... I wasn't sure if that other one wouldn't work, so that other probe is going to survive. It's still landing at a different speed, it looks like. Or maybe not. Down on the ground, I can face this direction, and we can just glide ourselves down. Technically complete the flight. At this speed, I will not survive. Where's our engine level? Where did it go? I wanted to see it crash. Right. Back on the earth. Or back on the carbon. I lost it. I need to set a flag. Well, all right, I'm just going to put it in English. Whatever. First Kerbal. What's a human? First Kerbal in space. Land it here. Let's go. All right. How long have we been going? 2 hours. 2 hours. I'm still going to do, it's not going to take very long. I'm going to do the Mercury flight. Get back on there. The Mercury flight is our American flight. It's not even an orbital flight. But it's the first American in space. And that's Alan Shepard. And as I was saying previously, this year, 1961, in January, America had started launching chimpanzees into space using these rockets. But by the time we got to the middle of the year, that is I'm actually going to, like I said, I can't remember where I just put any of my notes around, because I kind of just put the basic dates of when this happened. But so let's get rid of this commie music. And switch this to the Kerbal States of Kerbalism. Now Mercury Redstone. In this game, the planet Mercury is called Moho. So I'm calling this Kerbal program the Moho program, because I'm so original. Now, the real life ones are Moho Redstone, Minor Moho Red Brick, just because, again, I can't really think of anything cooler. If we recall, this is a derivative of the Juno rocket, which was used to launch the first Explorer 1 satellite. And again, there was 60 launches that happened this year between the Soviets and the U.S. Most of them were the U.S. Most of them were the U.S. launching polar spy satellites. Might launch another one of those, too. But lots of those went up, and those were the ones that were, they were put into orbit. They were decreased from orbit, just like we just saw Yuri Gagarin do. And then they were caught by spy planes, or they were recovered from like parachutes. They were left, and it was just they put these things in the polar orbit. And but anyway, let's get there were also what's called the electronic. There were also surveillance, communication, reflection, relay satellites that were put in orbit. That were controlled electronically. Basically called, it's called ELINT, Electronics Intelligence, ELINT. Those have since then have been launched every single year. They're still launched. A lot of the larger launches, Elon Musk's launches, the larger Falcon launches that are happening yearly now, they're the modern version of these electronic surveillance or electronic intelligence satellites. So, Alan, where's Alan? I have Gus, Pete, Mike, John. Oh man, we got to find out. It's kind of funny. So these the Mercury 7 astronauts. Actually, let's take a look at those guys. Now, there's a movie that's pretty cool. As far as how accurate it is, I mean, there's books written about the accuracy of the movie, the right stuff. But one thing that's clear is John Glenn. I don't know what John Glenn's deal was. He strikes me as a, you know, I should know this because a lot of these guys' religion was kept under wraps, and of course, every at that time in the 60s, everybody's religion was. Well, everybody was considered a Christian. Like, of course. It was like, of course they're a Christian. I don't think it was ever... In the 1960s, at this point, the idea of somebody being a Christian was just not in question. Unless, of course, they were... Well, then, yeah, if it was in question, it would have been a big deal. So what my point is that these Mercury 7 astronauts, whatever their actual true internal beliefs were, what their true relationship was with the Lord Jesus Christ, I can't say. But John Glenn seemed to actually play the part of sort of a true, like, hey, guys, we got to set a good example. We got to, we have children watching us. We got to be faithful to our wives. We have to not swear. We have to, like, all this stuff. He was, John Glenn was, like, basically, like, seen as, like, a square by the other ones. So the Mercury 7 astronauts, I'm going to read their names here. Am I actually? Let me bring them up instead of yapping on here. Yeah. So I brought that before. Wally Schirra, Deke Slayton, John Glenn, Scott Carpenter, Alan Shepard, Gus Grissom, and Gordon Cooper. Those are the original ones from 1959. They did change. So, yeah, but these guys were... The thing to remember about these guys is they're pilots, and a lot of them had seen combat, and they were the best of the best. Their attitude, if you look at their attitude, they were certainly... They were hyper-competitive with each other and everything else. But there is a lot of known contention between John Glenn and a lot of these other guys who enjoyed partying, basically. Now, I don't know what the extent of their partying was. It was just simply going and feeling a woman's thigh at a bar, I have no reason not to think that these guys were somehow were not susceptible to the wily ways of So anyway, the first guy was Alan Shepard. And what is this song? we're going to have to fast forward it to the morning. Because I believe this flight would have, the first flight would have been from, so what is this? This is the Mercury Redstone 3, I believe. Freedom 7 was the name of it. Alan Shepard. The first time an American was actually sent to space. And this happened not long after. This happened in May of 1961. Where about the Yuri Gagarin flight, which is again Vostok 1, which that happened in April. So this is a month later. Now I'm not going to do the other flights this year, but there was a Vostok 2 that happened, this year, and then there was also another ballistic flight. Whoops. Let's fast forward this a little bit so we have more light, and let's get this guy off the ground. What was I doing? I was getting Alan. I was trying to find, I can't find Alan Kermit. Alan Kerman anywhere. He's out there flirting with all those horrible women. So I'm gonna go to the astronaut complex. Do I have an Alan? I should have an Alan. Al. Where is he? He's in the cockpit. He's messing. What is he doing in that cockpit of that F4 wizard? Because all my Kerbals, they're all veterans. They're all veterans of the war. He's in the F4 wizard, so I'm going to have to get that. All right, so we're going to have to get him in from the track station. If I had time, I would just get whatever airplane he's in and fly it to the station. There's an F4 wizard that he's in. Where is it? Oh dear. So the Kerbals don't show up. But the... Oh boy, there's a lot of F4 wizards. Oh man. I gotta find Alan. This is the last flight I'm gonna do. So I gotta find... Well, it looks like there's only two F4 wizards. All right, let's try the first one. All we gotta do is recover them. All right, let's recover that F4. No Kerbal in that one. There he is. All right, we got him back. Let's get back to the station. I hate this song. So lame. Calendar girl. It's also like, this is when the debauchery all really started, isn't it? Because you had people that were returned back from the war, and then they had their children who were kind of looking back. And the stuff that the people that the World War II parents took for granted, that a child growing up would be like didn't really think to like know about. So like, there's like I don't know what I'm talking about. I mean, obviously the generation gap is a thing. And is there for a reason. Yeah, stop doing that. Okay. We got Al back. Here he is. Al Kerman. Putting him in there. Now, this looks kind of bad. This is... Again, this is the only what this thing up here is a launch escape system. All right, we're gonna launch this from. Let's do it. Just do it. We're just gonna see how high I can get. Again, this is it. This is a ballistic flight. The Americans were taking it slow. They did two this year. The other one was Gus Grissom. Gus Grissom did the second one of these this year. His had a problem. His actually sank to the seat. He couldn't get out. He almost died. There's a lot of conspiracy theories around Gus Grissom. If you take a look, Gus Grissom's son, I believe. I think it's his son. Yeah, has a lot of problems with the fact that Gus Grissom's the one that ended up dying in Apollo 1, along with two other astronauts, Ed White and Ed Chaffee, and well, I know their names are White and Chaffee. I don't remember their first names. It's Ed White. I forgot Chaffee's first name. Okay. So let's get us into a nice ballistic flight up here. So yeah, if there was the idea of this escape system was if there was a problem, this is still attached to the bell. The bell would detach from the rocket and pull this away to safety. Kind of tempted to kind of just try that out, but let's not do that. Let's just do it. So we got our, let's check my staging real quick. We got our first engine and then our thingy there. Then we're going to separate that launch escape system. And then we got our main. This is just a single stage. The rocket used on this is a Redstone. And these are all derivatives of nuclear missiles. What's that? Ooh, those two separatrons. Interesting. All right. Now this was if your parents had a TV during this time, they probably watched this flight on TV. As a matter of fact, I'm going to find it. Well, let me do that after I do the actual flight here. I really wish this didn't minimize the game. All right, let's do it. We're going to get ourselves into an equator orbit. No, we're not doing an orbit. We're just going to make sure we get into where we land in the water. This one's different from the Russian and the American program. There's different theories on what's the better thing to do, landing in the ocean versus landing on the desert. A lot of it, however, is going to be, the decision is based on availability. Obviously, the area around the Soviet Union has a lot more land around it, I would argue, than ocean. So it would make more sense for them to land things on the land. worry about the Americans for launching things off the coastline. They didn't worry about Okay. Looking at our ballistic arc. Oops, let's disappear some of those. Looking at our ballistic arc, you know, we've gotten pretty high up. Well, that's interesting. Not that high up. I didn't give it too much of an arc. I mean, we're still within space. But again, this is what America was doing with it. We're gonna separate. Let's separate this guy. Now these retro rockets are interesting, but the Americans did not have, like, it's pretty clear, like, because the Americans had different groups generating all these different technologies, so they had different rocket technologies as well. And different retro rocket technology. What the Mercury program was using is these three solid rockets, which for retro, it was a pack that was basically strapped onto the back of this thing. Here, let's we can look out see that how small this thing is. Now you can see examples of this thing in the Smithsonian as well. All right, we're already. But the bigger point of this was to prove. I didn't want to do that. Sorry about that. Well, I got rid of that thing. The biggest idea of this was to prove that that this thing wasn't gonna kill people. Now, and that people could survive in space. I'm going to jettison that heat shield as well. Didn't quite go as high as I wanted to, but that's fine. This wasn't supposed to be an orbital flight. The Redstone was mainly, like I said, a proof to prove the spacecraft itself, the ability for the Americans to create this thing that American or that humans could survive inside. By this point, they were testing it with apes, and then with Alan Shepard they had finally tested it with a human being who landed and survived. My very first time I remember seeing anything about astronauts or space was I Dream of Jeannie. When you first turned it on, when the I Dream of Jeannie first came on, you saw the it was like a cartoon of the, and I was very young. I mean, I was born in 1977, so I'm way too young for. I Dream of Jeannie is way before my time, but that had an astronaut landing, and I remember at the time thinking, well, astronauts just landed all the time from the sky. It was just kind of like, just that's what people did, but not the case. Each of these were very. Very well-known launches. It's only nowadays, and even now, people going to space and coming back are not. It's not a little deal. It's not something that. It's not like think about just air flight in the 19 teens. If a human being was on an airplane at a certain point in history, that human being is. They're considered amazing as opposed to if a human being gets on an airplane now, big deal. So, you know, logic only dictates at some point space travel and that sort of thing is going to become just another mundane reality, assuming that the Earth and everything proceeds the way it is. going to Mars. How will God resurrect an astronaut who dies in space? Well, that's the thing. God is the Lord of all time and space. So an astronaut dying in space is moving through space, but that's the thing. If since God is truly transcendent of time and space, then it theoretically doesn't matter where you are. For your molecules, because again, it's the same question of what happens if to all the people who were ever nuked. And I'm sure you asked this question tongue in cheek, Mr. Jamie Russell. Oh no. All right. Yeah, Mars is interesting because now you could use the argument. Well, people said the same thing about traveling across the Atlantic Ocean, but no, I mean it's not really. Yeah, it's pretty different. I mean, people cross the English Channel, so the Atlantic Ocean is just like a larger version of that. You could argue. Let's recover this spacecraft before something weird happens with the physics of this. Oops, getting my mouse cursors mixed up. Returning our flight, there we go. I'm actually tempted to do another. Oh, look at that, from a milestone. What is this? Ocean depth record. Entered orbit. What is all that? That's our other one. That's the thing. God can slow down or speed up whatever he wants to slow down or speed up, for sure. Or squeeze whatever he wants to squeeze. If he wants to squeeze every electron out of you, he could squeeze them all out of you and then put them all back. So I don't understand the idea of God being somehow limited the idea of God not being outside of time. Because if God is all powerful, then technically he could, if he wanted to, he could stop time. And he can replicate everything over and over and over again. Until he truly knew what was going to happen in every single circumstance, if he wanted to, because I would imagine that still wouldn't mean he wouldn't have infinite patience. Sort of tempted to do it. Hey, what's up, Mike? Good to see you, man. So I've been going for 2 hours and 24. I think I am going to launch another polar flight. I'm not, because that again, historically there was another. The Russians did another space flight with humans, and the Americans did another one of these Mercury Redstone flights, and there were a lot of other. Like I said, there were 60 different launches. The Thor Agena, or not the Rona satellites. these Corona satellites, the Corona program, or the Discovery program. These are the ones that were. they're putting the polar orbit so that they could get the most view of the Earth, because the Earth is spinning in one direction, the polar orbit is the other direction. Let's launch that from a normal one. Yeah, I've seen people discussing... I mean, that's the thing with... It's interesting to... I really wish... There's got to be a way for StreamYard to stop minimizing the thing, but maybe not. Let's get this thing going. That was a slow start. Spin this, because this is going to be a polar launch. Or Agena, or Thorn Agenda. But to have a question like that, as far as like why wouldn't God have a problem with people's molecules being scattered all over the place or something like that, is sort of like, the view of God has to be limited in order to even consider that to be a valid question. Oh man, what's going on here? I'm really... This may be a failed launch. They're going to have the operator blow this thing up. Now it's just become a ballistic missile. Because if God is within time and space, then if God is truly transcendent, then there isn't anything. And again, just the mere concept of being completely beyond or outside of or to have full control of over all things and all existence is just unimaginable, obviously. I'll make these stupid menus disappear. Come on. Pretty sure this is the most revised version of this I created. This shouldn't have any problems getting into orbit. A little bit slower. Now, because I'm not going in, I'm going to be going against the spin of the Earth, because I'm trying to put it in this polar orbit, which means I'm moving it northward. Moving it upward into that part of the planet. So it's going to take, and you can see my ballistic arc is really still, it wants to go from left to right. Limited by the logical possibility. True, but I don't see there's anything illogical about having sovereign power over space. Like if I could imagine, if it becomes apparent that, again, if we're talking about where things are and what state that they are and when that they are, then for somebody to be outside of that, then all of those states don't really matter. So if you're become to be in a state of there's the primordial, well, I suppose it's the that's some deep stuff, because it's getting into stuff about what is the substance of the thoughts and memories of like of God himself, and God's awareness of you, God's awareness of you in the future, God's awareness of you in the past. That's why it's good to start with some specific tenets first. such as God being good and God being perfect. Because again, it depends on what particular concept you're trying to prove or come to grips with. And there's also the matter, because if God isn't good, for example, then nothing really matters. If God isn't true, then there's not a lot that really matters anyway. You see our polar arc is growing. Yeah, that's the thing. And that's why the stuff about, you know, time itself, the concept of time, which is the concept of the motion of things in existence, because if you ask, who are you in yourself, the 18-year-old you, the 2-year-old you, the whatever part of you, they're all you. Now you have to look at a distinction between your own awareness of yourself and the reality of it, because there's still a distinction between your own reality. I'm not your own reality, between actual reality and your awareness of reality, because the thing that determines your own the thing that determines the actual reality is God. God's awareness of all things is the only thing keeping everything synchronized. So and that's ultimately the only thing that matters. God knows the totality of you. In all time. When your mind is only thinking of yourself within space. And that's why it's also important that God is outside of all that, of time and space. Because if he doesn't, then how would he know you? Just guessing about you, or he has people reporting in on you, that sort of thing. Like, I don't really believe that. He knows. All right, we've got a nice polar orbit. So as we spin up and down this thing, the Earth's going back and forth, and we can take pictures. It just takes enough time. So if people want to order, hey, we want some satellite photos of this peninsula, this city, blah, blah, blah. All right, well, it's going to take a couple hours or a couple days for the Earth to spin enough and for this thing to get in the right spot in order to view down. But at any point, at any given time, a satellite would be able to take a picture here. Now, I do want to, and then these things would take pictures, and then they would, this is going to detach, and then, because we're going to flip this thing around, the Agena rocket could flip around, and just like we just did with Yuri Gagarin, so it flip around, and then it would decrease its orbit, so they can sink back down and land after these things took pictures. The Leotardo. Yeah, that was totally Mel Brooks. Still looked old. So yeah, 1961, pretty crazy year. So stuff was getting revved up. Patrice Lumumba assassinated. The United Nations stormed. The announcement of Vietnam escalation was still going on. Well, that happened the previous year, but JFK being sworn in. This is also the year JFK gave the "We will go to the moon" speech. Again, Bay of Pigs. I'm just gonna look up some quick stuff. I know there's always gonna be upheaval. I think that's the basics of it. I'm gonna make sure I don't miss it. Every time I end this, I end up finding something that I'm like, oh, I really wish I would have mentioned that. Let's see. Let me just do one more search for 1961, like the general prices, and then we're gonna land. Let's get this thing landed. We've taken this thing around the Earth, around its polar orbit, and see as it spins around. Here's its view, and then the Earth is spinning. Now we're gonna bring this thing down. It has a heat shield on it now, but I did have to redesign it. And I don't care if this one comes down in the water or not. Which direction is this going? This is 3 minutes and this is 30 minutes. Great. So let's flip it right around. All right, so we've just snapped all the pictures for our government agencies. We're gonna a nice little deorbit burn. And as you can see, our orbit is shrunk now to where it's going straight into the clouds. Bloomp. Whoops, we were stopped the engine. So now we are landing right in there. Not exactly there, because we're going to hit the atmosphere. And so we're going to also detach. All this stuff's going to detach. We are going to want to close that. Can we flip around? Barely. This thing has some kind of a maneuver, a reaction wheel in it that's causing it to be able to very basically maneuver. Let's return that film. Take pictures of the Soviets. Memorizing, used to memorize presidential addresses. Was that just for fun or just generally? So I did three launches on this. Or no, actually I did four. Including, so this polar launch was an extra one. But this still ended up being just about 3 hours long. It's crazy. I should just get the full version of of StreamYard. Either that or just not make these live. I think it's fun doing them live. All right, let's fast forward this guy down to the clouds. All right, we're going to wrap it up with some Apache with Jorgen Ingman.
In a box. Dream Whip. For real homemade taste and texture. All you do is whip it up with milk and vanilla. But what Dream Whip does for desserts is a real surprise. On Jell-O puddings, pumpkin pie, gingerbread, strawberry shortcake. Light, fluffy Dream Whip makes everything it touches taste better, more exciting. Yet it's so lusciously low in calories. Only 17 preserving. And Dream Whip stays fresh so long. You can make it hours before dinner. It won't wilt or separate like other toppings. In fact, extra Dream Whip will stay fresh for days in your refrigerator. Keep several boxes handy on your pantry shelf. Always fresh, ready, and waiting. That's Dream Whip, another fine product of General Foods.
I don't want to rush things, but if you've been thinking of getting a Polaroid 10-second automatic camera for Christmas, why not get it now? Then you won't miss all those great fall shots, like football games. Well, I got one of them. Nice and sharp, too. And then there's Halloween. That's a cute one. And there's Thanksgiving snapshots, too. There's no fun like seeing the picture 10 seconds after you take it. So why wait till Christmas and miss those fall pictures? Get a Polaroid 10-second camera now. This newest model costs less than $75. See your dealer.